So, I'm an educator. Would I call myself an official maker? No. But I definitely like creating and making. Actually, I gave this love for making and creating a really authentic name when I was 11 years old. And to this day, when I engage in it, I still call it this in my inner monologue to this day. I like to call it making. It's coming. Making this. And when I think about my experiences of making-ish, from when I was a child to now as an educator, it never really related to experimentation or building structures or anything mechanical. My passion has always been to take obscure, foreign, complicated, and hard to explain topics and alter them to be better understood, embraced, and mean something to people who would have otherwise seen these topics as unrelatable. That's what I loved about making and creating. It compels audiences to feel a connection from your creation. Maybe get them to care about something they would have otherwise not been concerned about if they didn't pass by your creation. And when I think about who planted that seed, what ignited that love within me to do this, it wasn't just primarily my teachers or my family or my intrinsic love for learning. Much of my love for creating and making comes from hip-hop. Yes, folks. It was the late 1980s, early 1990s hip-hop movement that made me fall in love with learning, making, and creating. And it was hip-hop in its truest form that showed me what a real authentic maker culture was. Starting from nothing but a voice, a topic, and an audience, hip-hop is poetry to a tempo that has the ability to move your body, your mindset, and your consciousness. The artists didn't have access to backup singers or backup bands, music lessons, yet they still created verbal art. No less. To make beats in the absence of recording studios or instruments, DJs and producers tinkered with the products of other musicians and made their own authentic soundtracks and beats. Even in the absence of enough time and space to convey a message, hip-hop made space. Artists took the typical 4x8-bar structure of a regular 5-minute song and filled it with a multitude of words, ideas, literary devices, and jam-packed so much content in a 5-minute track. From art to dance, hip-hop took concrete surfaces and turned them into beautiful canvases and performance stages. The pioneers of the culture were tinkerers and makers, and it taught me how you can be amazingly creative with very limited resources. But that's not all it taught me. Through audio and video, I learned about oppression, strife, and racism. I learned about civil rights and what it meant to be critically conscious from the time I was 8 years old when I first heard Fight the Power by Public Enemy. It was in 1990, after hearing Queen Latifah's Ladies First, when I became an ally with female empowerment. And when I sat down with Salt-N-Pepa at their request to talk about sex, I learned at a very young age that sex is a serious topic that we should be discussing and shouldn't be ashamed of. Hip-hop, like Tupac Shakur's poem, is the rose that grew from concrete. An amazing culture that thrived in an environment where all the conditions for it to grow beautifully were stacked against it. So if that enduring art form can come from tinkerers and makers with limited resources, what conditions are we setting up for our students to thrive, be innovative, and most importantly, make creations that reflect who they truly are? What are we doing to allow students the space and freedom to engage in learning that represents their life, values, and lived experiences? Or are we exposing them to skills valued by the mainstream STEM and STEAM culture in our education system? Are we putting too much focus on getting building blocks like Lego and codable robots in our spaces? Products that often create conditions that encourage students to build, code, and do, but sometimes not much else. I'm not devaluing these products. I encourage you to use them, and I use them myself. But like all things in life, diversity is key. Have a multitude of tools and products in your spaces, and I implore you to look at your spaces and ask yourself critically, can my students create in numerous ways with these tools? Are the conditions set for my students to uniquely express themselves through working with these tools? And can my students use these tools to share a message that perhaps they've been meaning to share with their teachers, their peers, or the world? We live in complicated times, and our students are thriving in a complicated world. However, if you set the right conditions in your makerspaces, you can help your students, like hip-hop, defy all the odds that are stacked against them and inspire them to create something from nothing. Thank you.